I thank God for the privilege that he has given to me that I can share the word of God. I was telling you just now when you were worshiping, something happened in the heavenly places. I want to tell you about that quickly, and then we are going to teach you how to become rich. Hallelujah. Amen. All right. When we worshiped, suddenly the Lord told me that a lot of you are struggling not because you are bad people. A lot of you are struggling not because Jesus is not faithful to the promises. A lot of you are struggling because there is a war in the heavenly places. Thank you, Lord. Amen. And the war, you know, is already won. Jesus has already won the war. But then for you to be a partaker of that victory, you need to know something. Know something. What is it that you and I need to know this morning? You need to know that somebody has passed through the heavens. All right? When you know this, when you begin to pray, in the name of the one who conquered death and passed through the heavens, no demonic stronghold can anymore be over your head. In Jesus' name, Revival Church, all of you this morning, you are free. You are free. You don't have to go back. It's over. The battle has been won. You're asking me, Pastor, so simply, nothing dramatic about it. Actually, there is no drama in Christian life. There's no drama, really. It is finished for you. Because somebody has passed through the heavens. Did you know that there is a battle in the heavenly places? You read about that in the book of Ephesians chapter 2. At your convenience, you must read that. It says about the principles, the wicked hosts of darkness in the heavenly places. It's mentioned there in the book of Ephesians 2. So many other places. Paul was such an anointed man of God. When he prayed, he was always concerned about the people. So he understood that the Corinthian church, the Ephesian church, they were all good people. They were righteous people. They were right people. Amen. But still they were struggling. This morning you are right people. You are the right people. You are righteous people because you believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Because you believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, God sees you in the right places. You may not be good people. I'm not a good person, ask my wife occasionally. But I am a right person. Hallelujah. I'm a right person. I may not be a good person for many people. The devil doesn't like me at all. He doesn't think I'm good for his kingdom. But I'm a right person. Hallelujah. How many right people are here? We are right because we believe in Jesus Christ. You know, Mary of Magdalene, she wasn't good. Jesus called her right. You're right. So the Pharisees were about to throw stones. Jesus said, no, she's right. In my presence, she's right. The same way, we are right. We are righteous because we trust in Jesus. Hallelujah. So don't try to change yourself again and again. And how can be a little more? How can I be more loving? How can I be more? How can I bring fruit into, you know, the gifts of the Holy Spirit? Or how can I bring fruit into? Say, stop trying all this. Turn to your neighbor and say, stop trying to make yourself good. That doesn't work. You can. Hello. You can make yourself good. I know this. Now, don't go the way I went, because I did this for many years and I found out I was getting very, my dad will be able to tell me the right language. Narcissistic means self-centered, right, Papa? I should ask my dad. He's a, you know, double MA from some of the best colleges. Hallelujah, praise God. So many times, you know, we think, you know, we need to be a, the more I try to correct myself and the more I try to become holy, I found out one thing in my life. I don't want you to learn it the hard way. I began to be self-centered. How holy am I? Does God really love me? Today, how can I please God a little more? Saints, all that is of the law. Did you understand that? Start looking at Jesus. When you look at Jesus, you'll become like him. Yeah, that's a simple gospel. And when I began to change, when Jesus began to change me like that, I was able to love everybody. When I was looking at myself, me, Pastor Thomas George, Pastor George Samuel, we 3, 5, 4 or 5 people who agree to whatever we say. Now, they are not responsible, I am. I realized that was becoming a Pharisee club. Hello. That's not Jesus club. Jesus club is, I love my brother and sister as they are. I will give them time to change. Hello, hello, hello. I will give them time to change. Because Jesus was patient with me all these years. Even when I was making mistakes, he still loved me. He said, don't give up. So this morning, people of God, let us get rid of once and for all. In the Malayalam service, we did that. In the English service, we are going to say, we are going to get rid of making ourselves good. Stop it. Hallelujah. Just to let you know, we are having a Malayalam service only for one or two people. All right? Amen. Hallelujah. God's desire for us is that we have a church which is always speaking English. Hallelujah. Amen. All right. Okay. Just letting you know so that you can start praying. Somebody was threatened the other day. He said, Pastor, why do you want to have a... We are not excluding anybody. This church includes people, not excludes people. Hallelujah. We don't exclude anybody here. Hallelujah. Jesus never excluded me from anything. Why should I go around excluding other people? Amen. So remember, God has called you right because you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. So being right people and being given the best promises that heaven can give, why should some of you still struggle? Because there was a battle in the heavenly places. This morning it is finished. Amen. That's what happened during the worship. Amen. Amen. So many things helped. The children worship. Dennis gave a word which was very prophetic. I am declaring that as I was praying, I said, something was broken. You will never be the same again. Hallelujah. Amen. Keep that in your mind. Because now you know somebody passed through the heavens. They could not keep Jesus in the grave. They kept Moses in the grave. They kept Elijah in the grave. They kept Abel in the grave. They all waited under the authority of death. Finally, somebody came who broke death. Wow. Somebody came who destroyed death. You know, all the great men of God, they never went up. They all died. And they were all waiting in, man of God, in Hades, right? Hades. Not hell, but Hades. They were all waiting. And then what happened? They tried to go up, but Mr. Death came and said, no. You may have been a good person, but I still have authority over you. Death was standing over them. Then came somebody who was in the grave for 3 days. Oh, I get the thrill when I imagine that. Ooh. Can you for a minute think of what happened in Hades? How many of you know that Jesus went down to Hades? Jesus, how many of you know that Jesus died on the cross? Yes? Yeah. Now some of you new people, I want you to know Jesus died on the cross. There was no magic. He died on the cross. Some people teach that actually it was not Jesus who died. Somebody else died. That's a lie. It was Jesus who died. Jesus died on the cross. Every ounce of his blood was shed. Hallelujah. And then they put him in a grave. He didn't vanish from there also. I said, Jesus is not an escape artist. He's not scared of anybody. Amen. He went to the grave. And then his soul went into Hades. The hell has... How many parts? Two parts, three parts. Hell has at least two parts. One is Hades, one is the lower parts of the hell. The lower parts of the hell is where a lot of bad people are. Hades is a place where all the saints of God who lived before Jesus was. Did you get that? Amen. So still they could not go up to heaven. Still they could not go up to heaven. Why? Because even Hades was under the spirit of death. So Jesus went to Hades. And while he was in Hades, he did go and speak to people who had died before his time. Amen. So the gospel was preached to everybody. Now there is nobody without any excuse. Hallelujah. Now after preaching the gospel, Jesus was waiting. Mr. Lucifer thought that he had Jesus. He, once in a while, Lucifer, you know, send an SMS and Instagram and all that to God. Did you know that I got your son, huh? God didn't say anything. Jesus didn't do anything. Amen. They just kept quiet. On the third day. Can you imagine what happened on the third day? The demons and Mr. Lucifer had the greatest attack of his life. Jesus, who was standing very, very quietly, suddenly the power of God came upon him. He rose again. When he rose up, he destroyed death. He didn't destroy death. Death had to move back. With Jesus, all the saints went. In fact, Hades is known as today's paradise. Not paradise. Third heaven. How many of you been to third heaven? Anybody? Third heaven. You went to third heaven. Oh, Paul has got female counterparts in 2000. Praise the Lord. Lift your hands and praise. You went to third heaven. Please give me an invitation too. Hallelujah. This third heaven is Hades. That the whole thing was lifted up. Today, the church, the headquarters of the church is the third heaven. Hello? It's okay. It's okay. It's all right. Praise God. Amen. So we went up. That is why as soon as you're born again, you are seated in the heavenly places in Christ. It is that heavenly places. Did you get that, people? Amen. Because Jesus went up. Because you are placed in the heavenly places. There is no reason why any spiritual attack should be upon you. Either corporately or personally. How many of you understood that? Today, if you know this, your life is changing. Amen. If you are placed in the heavenly places, what is the position of demons? The position of the demons are underneath your feet. That's what happened today. Every church needs to be lifted up. Today this was lifted up. In the days to come, you will see. God is doing it. All right, let's go into this message. This message is titled, How to Make You Rich. Turn to your neighbor and say, I want to become rich. How many of you want to become rich? Lift your hands and praise God. Oh, such wonderful holy people. They don't want to become rich. All right, do one thing. Whenever you get a paycheck, like, give me a call. I will come and lift your paychecks. Hallelujah. It is the Lord's desire that his people live in wealth. Hallelujah. All people who do not wealth, I repeat, if you do not want it, give me a call. We want it. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Here is today's message. This is going to go on. This message is based on a word which the Lord Jesus Christ gave to us. It is mentioned in Ephesians 2, 4 to 6. Let's read that quickly. Here is the word. Yes. Show it. Ephesians 2, 6. 2, 4 to 7. But God, let's read it together, saints. God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, has quickened us together with Christ. By grace you are saved. Next. That in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us through Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. This is a prophetic word which the Lord gave to us 2-3 weeks ago. We have started to meditate on that. When the Lord tells us to move to another verse, we move to another verse. Aren't you happy that we are a church who go by what God tells us to do? Amen. When we move as God tells us to move, things will begin to happen. When we move according to our own ideas, things wait. Hallelujah. Tell somebody the waiting time is over. Amen. We are moving with the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hallelujah. So here, number one, I told you 2 weeks ago that God is a God of love. God is not a God of condemnation. Even if you make mistakes, don't feel bad about it. Don't take condemnation into your heart, because there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Condemnation means what? Not eternal condemnation. Condemnation means, let's say, for example, I don't know why I'm picking upon Jill today. Supposing I slap Jill today. She's a nice saint, so she's going to forgive me. But I'm going to feel guilty. Amen. This guilt can make me, lead me to, oh, what a, she was a, such a precious saint. I didn't have to do that. I didn't have to do, oh Lord, forgive me. Lord, will you forgive me? How could I do that, a pastor like me? How could I do it? How could I do it? No answer. God doesn't answer that. You know why? Because he has already revealed that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. We need to know. There is no condemnation. Now don't ask me, can I go on beating Jill? No. If I do that, she will call 911. Hello. To say the least. Please don't ask questions like, if you teach like this, will you continue to sin? No, we won't. Praise the Lord. Turn to your neighbor and say, I didn't come to sin. I came to glorify God. Tell your neighbor and say that. I am not here to sin. Hallelujah. I came to glorify my God. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So people of God, remember, God is a God of love. Amen. And God has told us, spoken to us through the scriptures, that God, who is rich in mercy. See, what a wealthy God we serve. He did not say God, who is a miser in riches. God did not say that. Did he say that? I will give mercy only to some people. I will give mercy to my people, the children of Abraham by the flesh. God, who is rich in mercy. And like, what is the next thing? For his stingy love, verse 4. Sharon, what's your hurry? For a stingy love. You know, we go to God for a little bit of love and God says, all right, I will write a check for you, but please don't cash it before 6 months. And even when you do that, give me a call before you do that. That's not God. You go to God for love and you know what God does? How much? Here, take me. Take my son. That's the way God is. Who is rich in mercy? Wherewith he loved us. For his great love, wherewith he loved us. Next verse 5. Even when we were dead in sins. Listen. Even when you were dead in sins. And me too. He loved us. Many of us, I used to think that till I became good, God would never love me. Honestly, saints. How blessed are you to know the truth? I used to think like that for a long time. So I used to continuously try to become good. From today, I shall be good. God love me. That doesn't work that way. It's not about you being good. It's about His loving you. His love inside us makes us good. Amen. Hallelujah. So look at that. Even when we were dead in sins, He quickened us together with Christ. Now here is an answer for you. He loves you even when you and I were dead in sins, not to leave us there. See what He does? He has quickened us. Hey, if any of you think that you were born again by your own decision, can you rewrite your testimony? No. In 1925, the preacher came to the town and I gave my life to Jesus. Well, you did give your life to Jesus, but why? Because His grace came upon you. Because His grace told you, child, why don't you receive me? Somebody came to the door of your heart and said, knock, 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 hello. Is my loved one at home? Hello. And you said, yay, I am here. And He said, come alive. That's what it means to be born again. Amen. When we sing that Malayalam song, it's in English too. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. The Malayalam song is, Yeshuvil en thodane kanden. Enikellam ayavane. Avan enne kandathi ennigana varu. It says, avan enne. The writer actually says, how could he found me? No, I found him, which is true. But I always like to sing, he found me. Avan enne kandathi, he found me. I like to believe that because that is grace. He found me. Isn't that right? He found you, he found me. You say, without the help of God, how can you find God? He has to find you first, he has already done it. God is looking all over the world through a big, you can call it a big light. What's the name of that light? Jesus. Let's imagine he's scanning all over the world. Yeah, he sees there somebody who's crying. That light. God says, come. I know what you need. You're broken. You don't have a home. You don't have anybody to help you. Let me. Wherever grace is required. Where is Miriam? What is the song you wanted to sing about grace today? When sin runs deep, grace. When sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is, okay, you remember the song? Where sin runs deep, meaning wherever there is a need, okay, He is there. If you are failed, that is where He is. If you are disappointed, that is where He is. If you think you are consistently a failure, that is where you can expect Him to move maximum. Somebody said, I heard that message. Yeah, Cain, Abel, two people. Abel was on fire for God, never a failure, powerful worship leader, powerful preacher, praise the Lord. Cain, always a failure. But who did God come to? That's God. If you have failed, He's right there with you. My child, I love you. I want you. Anybody here who has ever failed in life? Oh, such wonderful, victorious people. A wonderful news for you. The more you have failed, the more grace you have. I'm not saying you go and fail again. No. I didn't say that. I said because you keep on. You're failing. Many of you are failing because of so many reasons. Not because you're bad people. It is. You can let us rephrase it like this. If you have consistent failures in your life, you are the best applicant to receive more grace. Did you get it? Hallelujah. So you see, it is by grace and He has quickened us together with Christ. Next verse 6. He has raised us up together, made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Where are you seated, people of God? You are seated in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. If you have believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, and if you have chosen to obey all his commandments, starting with baptism in water, moving on to baptism in the Holy Spirit. Amen. Not because you do these things, but because you believe you are already in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Amen. And then why does God do it? That's the point we are coming to. Why does God make us to sit in the heavenly places with him? Number one, because of love. And two, we are going to read it. Come on, read it together. He has raised us up together. Come on, church. Made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Verse 7, that in the days to ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us through Christ Jesus. That's why. He has a plan for me. When people say God has a plan for you, you can write this down as part of God's plan. God's plan for me is that he may show in the ages to come the exceeding riches of his grace. And riches is something I want you to know. What exactly are the riches that God is going to give to you? Amen. That is why I said how to become rich. So those who were in a shock, come back in Jesus' name. Come alive. Some of you are almost shocked and going out of the church. Don't do that. We are teaching you how to have the spiritual riches of God. Here is principle number one. Here we go. How to become rich. I have titled this message as "You Are Rich the Jesus Way." Did you get the message today? You are rich the Jesus way. Turn to your neighbor if you like to and say, "You are rich the Jesus way. You are rich the Jesus way." Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Do not let the devil tell you that guy is teaching you all prosperity and he wants all your tithe in the pocket so that he can buy a jet. Hallelujah. I don't need your tithe to buy my jet. God will give it to me free. Somebody say hallelujah. We just broke the devil up, gave him a kick in the back. Hallelujah. When God teaches his children how to prosper, immediately comes some Pharisee telling prosperity theology. And the fellow comes to America to take money from other people. Hallelujah. I'm not talking about any of the visiting pastors who came here, but I know a bit. They wax eloquent about the lifestyle of America, rich Americans. But they have to come to America to take our money. Did you understand that? God wants to prosper everybody. Turn to your neighbor and say, God wants to prosper everybody. Hallelujah. Poverty doesn't take you to heaven. If anybody ever told you that poor people go to heaven, you got a wrong idea. Yeah, some people told me, you know, Pastor, Lazarus went to heaven, so what? You want me to sit at some rich man's gate and have dogs licking the soles of my feet? Find out somebody else. Why did Lazarus go to heaven? Not because he was poor. Because he believed in God. Somebody need to get this right today. Oh my God, then Abraham must be in hell today. Did you know Abraham was the richest man? How? I don't want his riches. Lord of cattle. Wow. Make a lot of problem in America. No, not for me. I don't want cattle. Yeah. Probably I can think of having a cattle farm in India. Not a bad idea. But I don't want cattle. Praise God. But Abraham was rich. So was Isaac. So was Jacob. Amen. Job. Praise God. But I don't want Job's problems. Hallelujah. Bottom line, people of God, please remember, God wants to add on. God is an adding. Hallelujah. Jiju is very excited today. Suddenly Jiju thought of the farm. Jiju and I are going to start. Hallelujah. Praise God. What's the principle of being rich? Number one, being rich, there are seven principles of having riches. Today we are going to take not much, probably one. Here is the first principle which I want you to have an attitude of I have. The principle of I have. Turn to your neighbor and say, the principle of I have. Seven principles. Principle number one is I have. The principle of I have. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You are rich because you have. Now, if I want to invest, a couple of millions, which is in my in a Swiss bank, my God, he's just going. Somebody will call the IRS, sell that fellow. All right. So if I want to start a business or a venture, what should I have with me? If I were to invest something, what should I have? Nibu Sini, don't say anything. Hallelujah. Okay. What should I have? I should have a capital. I need something where I can invest. Hallelujah. I need to have that, right? There are young, very smart young businessmen sitting here. Praise God. Amen. So you need to have something before you begin to invest. Without investing, you cannot become rich. Amen. So you need to have. The stewards, three of them, were given something. They were all given something to work with. This morning, people of God, I want you to know, when you are seated in the heavenly places, He has blessed you with everything that you need. And that everything that you need is known as one person, Jesus Christ. If you have Jesus, you have everything. That is why Jesus told the Pharisees, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Jesus said, "Go and empty yourself of all these riches which you think is great, so that you can get the greatest rich, which is Jesus Himself." You know why sometimes God takes us through situations where we think that we are losing a lot of money. I failed in this. I failed in that. Things are not working. Please know there is a spiritual principle working in your life. Never think that God has left you high and dry. Never think, my business failed. Nothing is working for me. I had an old car. There is not even money to put in the gas. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, because God has removed some riches which you trusted. He is putting His own rich. The name is Jesus. God is removing, depleting the riches of the world so that He can put Jesus Himself. Amen. I've told you this many times. I'm going to tell you again. There has been times in my life when I didn't have money to put tithe, leave alone tithe. I should make some money to give tithe. Right? I should have an income to put tithe. Hallelujah. I did not even have 5 paisa. I told you what I did, remember? I would go to a church. They would pass the offertory box. When they pass the offertory box, I will stand. I'll be very spiritual. Because He lives. Because I don't want to be embarrassed when the usher takes in the money. And I can face tomorrow. And I look at Rina. If she has something, no, she has nothing with her also. Miria would be there like a baby. And Achu would be there. I suddenly had a thought. I said, "Lord, why don't I do things?" When the offertory bag hit, I said, "Lord, I am jumping into the offertory bag." When you have nothing to give, give yourself a... That's the next level, Pastor. Yeah, if you don't have anything to give, put yourself in the offertory bag. That's why I'm standing here today. Did you ever think of that? And because I put myself in that offertory bag, He also came with me totally. When I hear of great pastors preaching about whatever they had, they gave it to the Lord and went to the missionary work, I said, "Lord, what did I have to give You?" I had nothing. All I had, some people are thinking in Malayalam, even itra daridra vasiyaru. Hallelujah. Whatever I had, I said, "Lord, this offertory bag is too big for me to get in, but please know that I am there. I'm there. I'm there." And I know what He told me. I'm there too. I'm there too. Wherever the heart is broken, wherever there is a depletion, have no doubt He's right there with you. Amen. So the beginning or the first principle of becoming rich is by having Jesus in your heart completely. No, I didn't say you have to obey. I did not say about baptism. I did not say all those things will come later. But have you Jesus? That's the million. What is $1 million for Jesus? That's a big question. The greatest question. Having Jesus is everything. The Bible tells you, if you have, more will be given. Whosoever has, more will be given. Hey, did you hear that, saints? Whatever you have in Christ, appreciated. You know how many times? Here is example number one. When I drive in here, I see so many cars. I said, "Lord, wow, look at that." Yeah. Some of you who were here right from the beginning, aren't you excited? So many cars. Look at the church. Turn around, look at the church. It's full. Hi, full church. Aren't you happy? Those of you who we started, yeah. You know, one of the reasons God said, be happy for two people. I said, yeah. Lord, how long? Two people. Happy for five people. Happy for seven people. Not much if you're truly grateful. I have. Thank you. I have. I'm grateful for whatever I have. When sometimes we don't have, say, Lord, I have an ability to talk. I can hear. I can see. I have the ability to walk. When I was limping around like this, some of you didn't see it. I was actually dancing, you know. Dancing into the church like this. That is the day I began to realize, Lord, what a joy it is that I have two legs. 2 days ago, I sent to my family the picture of my leg. And I myself was shocked. I said, how can I have this leg? And now when I look at my leg, I said, wow, what beautiful legs. Leelandi said, how beautiful are the legs of those who preach the gospel. Whatever you have, saints, just thank God for that. Did you know I'm grateful to God for everybody who comes to church? How about you? Are you grateful to God? Because these are the people who you really have to support you in prayer. All right, we may not be perfect. None of us are perfect. But there is somebody here in Philadelphia who cares for you at least 1%. Can I hear a word of thank you, Jesus, today? Young people, develop this attitude of becoming rich. I have. When you begin to acknowledge 2 cars, 5 cars comes. Come. When you acknowledge 5, 10 come. When you acknowledge 10, another 100 comes. Amen. The principle of having. Now, principle of having is the first principle of becoming rich. And you know, I have told you many times, I don't want to say that. Complaining and griping and finding fault and all that begins to take away this riches. Because God sees and says, son, Lord, I've given you so much. Should you be happy? Yeah, Lord, you gave me so much, but look at so and so. So and so has more. The Lord is saying, why do you worry about somebody else? Have I not satisfied you? Don't you have 3 times meal on your table? Don't you have health? Have I not given you a church? Have I not given you everything you want? Can you not live decently? How many of you have at least 2 pairs of clothes? Hey, come on. Am I intimidating you? No, I'm asking you in love. Just that I get a little excited. Forgive me. Someday I'm praying God will take us to Syria. Oh, I hope nobody ran away. Praise God. You know what is happening to Christian or any refugees all over the world? Because of some demoniac who suddenly thought he's going to take over the whole world. You know what? Sisters, you want to know what's happening? There are sisters running around to cover their shame. Are you blessed? Brothers, how many of you like to be in a situation where suddenly some demonic comes and takes care of your beautiful wife and your children and in front of them kills you or in front of them does something to you and make you to say, either you become like this, otherwise your wife and children are killed. How do you like to be in that position? Haven't we better? Isn't there something to be happy about? Something to say, Hank, thank you. I have peace in my heart. I have a church to pray for. The greatest thing is I have the Lord Jesus Christ. So many wonderful people in the world, more intelligent, cleverer, with great education. They have still not had the greatest wealth, but we have. Jesus. Amen. Another thing we're going to pray. This morning the Lord impressed me. I think I'll go on with that in this service also. We have to. You say Jesus, you have Jesus in your heart. There is another level which God wants you to have. It is another person of the Trinity. You know his name? Christianity cannot be successful if you don't have this person with you. Having this person, I tell you, is it. If you have that person, that's it. He's the Holy Spirit. I want to tell this church very clearly. The Holy Spirit is the person through whom Jesus heals. The Holy Spirit is the person through whom demons are cast out. The Holy Spirit is the person through whom I am preaching to you this morning. The Holy Spirit is the person who is being given to us. Counselor, comforter, the great teacher. When you say you have everything, that means you have the Holy Spirit. Two things I want to quickly comes to me. Number one, the book of Matthew says, ask, it shall be given to you. And then he says, how much more the Father gives good things to those who ask them. That is in the book of Matthew. But when it comes to Luke, the same thing he says, how much more will the Heavenly Father give you the Holy Spirit? Now both these were written by the Holy Spirit through Matthew and Luke, correct? How can we understand everything? If you have the Holy Spirit, you have everything. Here is the second thing I want to share with you. Again, Pastor Anison K. Samuel told us a testimony when he was preaching here on in September. He said, somebody had, they were planning to buy a church, just like we are planning to. And they wanted so much of down payment. And they said, we don't have that kind of money. We don't have so many kind of millions. And he was traveling in a plane. Anybody remember that story? He was traveling in a plane. He said, Lord, where am I going to raise so many millions? And then he heard a voice. It's already given to you. He said, where? He was actually hiding under a cover. He said, where? And the Holy Spirit led him. If you have the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit is your down payment. The Holy Spirit is the down payment of all that is to come. If you have the Holy Spirit, you have everything. That is why such kind of people who were blessed with the Holy Spirit were called in the 1900s Pentecostals. Not because of anything else. If you have the Holy Spirit, I tell you, you have everything. If you have the Holy Spirit, you have heaven. If you have the Holy Spirit, you have power. If you have Holy Spirit, you have wisdom. If you have Holy Spirit, you have anything that you want. We need the Holy Spirit. How many of you think you need the Holy Spirit? Do you need to qualify for it? What do you think? Your greatest qualification is that Jesus Christ is in your life. When you are born again, it is an act of the Holy Spirit. Your being born again is definitely a work of the Holy Spirit. Now when I say born again, don't confuse it with baptism. Hello, many people have the wrong idea. To be born again does not mean baptism. Hello, pastors, you agree with me, don't you? Can I go ahead? Okay, listen. Being born again, being baptized in water sometimes go together. That happened in Pastor George's life. Sister Jesse's life. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. But it was different in my case. I think it was different in Pastor Thomas George's. It is different depending on the Lord's desire. Hallelujah. There is no rule like that. I accepted Jesus as the Lord of my life. You know when I accepted Jesus as the Lord of my life? When I was any 8-year-old boys here? Anybody? 8 years? Nobody. Okay. I accepted Jesus at the age of 8. Amen. Definitely there was a change. My life. Jesus came into my life. The Holy Spirit came into my life. I did not understand anything, but he came into my life. I simply said, thank God for my grandmother who is with the Lord. Because I was the best grandchild. She took a special concern over me to pray. You know what I meant. Hallelujah. And I had the privilege of living with her. God bless her memory. See, she led me to the Lord. And I was born again actually on that day when the Holy Spirit came upon me. I didn't know about it. Then, years later, the Holy Spirit led me into the waters of baptism. Even then, I did not know anything about baptism. I felt in my need, I need to be baptized. All right. Thank God. Thank God nobody pushed me and kicked me. And when I was sleeping, threw me into the tub and all that. Praise the Lord. Because such things don't work. Praise the Lord. You have to do it from your heart. All right. Praise God. But then again, the education became complete only when somebody told me you need to be baptized in the Holy Ghost with power. Oh boy. That was really eye-changing, mind-changing, awesome. I want to tell you how the Lord, just a quick thing. Are you with me, people? I know you are. I want to tell you how the Holy Spirit led me. Now even when I had the Holy Spirit in me, I did not fully understand the power of God, I was still ministering. One day I went to a meeting. I went to a meeting in a far off place from where Rina and I were living, and some very good faithful people would come, and we would be preaching the word of God. I would be preaching as I thought was awesome and all that. And then one day after our 4 o'clock meeting, there was a crusade that was being held in that part of the town. So the elder of that church told me, hey brother, let us go to that crusade. I said, all right, we'll go to the crusade. Let's go. So I went to the crusade and suddenly the Lord said, there is something here which you don't have in your meeting. I said, Lord, what is that? He said, the Holy Spirit. I am born again. I come on a missionary trip. God said, that's what you think. Lord, I am preaching in the Holy Spirit. He said, yes, but you need to have something more. I said, I want it. That is why we are here today. That is why we preach with boldness today. Did you understand that you're good people? You have Christ inside you, but you need to wait upon the Holy Spirit. He's already here. You need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Did you get that? Here is another story from history. There was a man called John Wesley who lived about 200, 300 years ago. Have you heard of John Wesley, people? John Wesley was the son of a British pastor called Thomas Wesley. And Thomas Wesley had so many children. I don't know how many, 16 or 17. And Thomas Wesley had a wonderful wife called Susanna Wesley. She's a great woman of God. I'll tell you about her sometime, okay? But John Wesley, one day, he was a pastor himself. He had a touch of God. He had Christ inside him. He came all the way to the United States of America in those days. He came by ship, not by flight. There was no planes in those days. He came. He held a crusade. Nothing happened. He was preaching. He was preaching the doctrine. He was standing on the pulpit and screaming. Nothing was happening. Hello. He was very disheartened. He went back home. On the way back, you know, I told you there are no planes there. In the ship, the ship suddenly began to face a big tempest, storm, tempest. Okay, everybody was running here and there. And John Wesley also, man of God, was running here and there. He felt he was also going to die. But there in the ship, as he was running around, he saw three people. They're very quiet. They were praying. They were holding hands. They were praying. There was so much of peace and serenity on their face. And John Wesley just came to them and said, sir, we are all scared. The ship is going to, you know, why are you so quiet? He said, Mr. Wesley, we need to talk to you about something. They made him to sit down and made him to understand the real gospel. The ship came back to England where he was, to London. And 3 months later, the power of God came upon John Wesley. Anybody who searches Christian history all over the world know what God has done through such an anointed, powerfully mighty man of God. You know, when John Wesley spoke, people used to come up with power. Even those days, people used to come under the power of God. People were being healed. Who did it? The Holy Spirit. That is the ministry part of the Holy Spirit. But I also want you to know the Holy Spirit can keep your nature from reacting to the devil and shouting and making a problem in your house. Did you know that? The Holy Spirit can empower you to love somebody. The Holy Spirit can make you to be submissive. The Holy Spirit can make you to be full of love. Oh yeah. Colossians 1:11. Quickly go there. I want you to know both sides of the ability of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit does all the ministry. Many people have taught, yeah, you need to have the baptism of the Holy Spirit for ministry. I'm telling you, you need to have the Holy Spirit for quality of life. Look at this. Can you read this with me, saints? Quickly. Strengthened with all might, according to his glorious power, unto all patience and long suffering with. Now this is no dig at you, okay? Please take it in a good way. If you ever desire to become a pastor, if you have a call of a pastor, you need this. Hello. I'm telling you in love. No offense. Please don't take offense. I love you. I will not offend you. Amen. But sometimes you need so much of patience. You can ask Reena sometimes. I pray. I said, Reena, how many times we have prayed? How many times we have told some people, see, this is the way it is. But they come back just like a attitude of elasticity. You stretch the elastic thing. You let go. It comes back to its original form. No, we don't sit down and condemn anybody because we are not condemned. How can we condemn other people? But many times when people make mistake, I am reminded, he was very patient with me at one time. Lord, you are so patient with me. Enable me to be patient with somebody else today. That is being a pastor. If you ever want to be a pastor or a pastor's wife, be prepared for patience. Hello. And I tell you from my life, it is impossible to be patient if you don't have the Holy Spirit. Somewhere along the way, it is likely to snap. Somewhere along the way, we just give up. I can't. I'm done. Let the Lord take up his people. But I tell you, the Holy Spirit says, no, son. I called into the ministry. I know the kind of people I have given to you. I am more than capable of making you a conqueror. Did somebody get the message? Because of patience. And the patience comes from the Holy Spirit. Do we need the Holy Spirit? The greatest rich, my brothers, my sisters, is having the Holy Spirit. If you have the Holy Spirit, you have everything. You have patience, you have love. A new changeover of life. Is somebody looking for a new fresh lease of life? A new chapter, a new beginning? Receive the Holy Spirit. He will give it to you. If somebody is thinking of, Pastor, I want to really start fresh. But what about those memories? What about people who have, you know, people who don't really, I have a favor with? The answer is very simple. The Holy Spirit. Yeah. He can do that. The Holy Spirit can do that. Did you hear me? If you are afraid of your past sins, if you think that somebody saw you, I say, is that person who saw you greater than God? Church, you're not answering me. Is that person, okay, you made a big mistake in front of everybody. You became a fool. And then he said, what to do? I've lost my testimony. I cannot be lifted up again. That is what you say. That is not what my God says. My God says, I will give you a fresh lease of life. And when I give you a fresh lease of life, who can stand against it? When I open a door, who can stand against it, says the Lord. Did you get the message, people of God? Because you have the Holy Spirit, nobody can put you down more than a minute. It is your choice. Receive the anointing today in Jesus' name. Stand up in the presence of God. To become rich is to have the have mentality. Is to have Jesus. Is to have the Holy Spirit. He is good. He loves you. Hand yourself over to him, which you have already done. Have the have attitude. Because you have, more will be added to you. Thank you, Jesus. Here is a song. Come down. Just one song. We're going to sing this song. And we will say grace for today. Come with me, okay? Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious pleadings. I am thine, O Lord, I have heard thy voice as it told thy love to thee. But I long to rise in the arms of faith and be closer drawn to thee. I need you, Lord. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. There are depths of love that I may be able to know till I cross the narrow sea. There are heights of joy that I may not reach till I rest in peace with thee. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious pleading. You know the verse before it, I'll just explain it to you and pray. Go before it, Shalin. See, there are depths of love, I'm telling you, which you can know before you cross the narrow sea. Don't wait to cross the narrow sea, saints. It'll come. But there are much depths. depths of love that we need to know. I want to tell you a quick testimony, and then I tell you about the only reason I'm staying in Philadelphia. My wife, because the Lord wants me to stand here. The only interest I have apart from that when I start was my dad, my mom, my brother and sister. Okay? But I'm standing here because years ago the Lord told me, don't move from Philadelphia. People were calling me to other, probably richer states. But the Lord said, don't move. Because I loved him, I said, all right, Lord, I will stand. There are depths of love I want you to know. And because I did that, he has blessed me with all of you. You don't know how precious each one of you are. And your children, every one of you. You're so precious to us. Hallelujah. Praise God. You're very precious. Amen. So say, Lord, please release more depths of love in my life. Come on. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to the precious bleeding side. Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding Son, to thy precious bleeding Son. Father, fill us with thy Holy Spirit. Baptize this entire church with thy Holy Spirit. Lord, we want the Holy Spirit immeasurably. You have promised that we may be able to not only do great things for you, but we may also become like you every day. That the nature, the divine nature will manifest. Lord, many of us have struggles at home. It's not because we are bad people. It's because of a war which you have removed today. We also need to be empowered that the new man full of love may be activated in our life. Lord, we acknowledge that we have everything that you tell us to have. We believe that. We declare it that we have. We thank you for the riches of grace that is upon us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and give you peace and victory. May you move forward in victory this entire week. Today I just felt like saying like this. If any of you have not given your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, today is the day when you can truly give your life to Jesus Christ. Just lift those blessed hands up. We will pray for you. If you really want to accept Jesus for the first time in your life, if you have already accepted Jesus, the Lord is with you. The Lord bless you. Keep coming back to the church. God loves you. Hallelujah. God bless you. Have a great week. All right. Amen.